Okay guys, this is going to be a little bit different of a video than I usually do. I'm going to walk you guys through the steps to build your own computer. Now there's really no reason why anyone should ever really buy a computer pre-built off the shelf. If you're going to buy a $600 computer from, you know, Target or Walmart or Best Buy, take that $600, build your own, and you'll have a much better machine in the end anyway. So, I'm just going to walk you guys through the components that you need to build a computer. Now, my build is pretty specific because I'm using a lot of parts out of my old computer and upgrading a few things into a new case. So first, you're going to need a case. The case pretty much can be chosen almost at the very end, so I shouldn't say first. The very first thing you should choose is your processor, which is underneath this heatsink. I'm going to take this heatsink off and put this new Hyper 212 Evo on there. So the first things to look at are your processor and motherboard. They kind of go together because whatever socket, which is, you know, the size and pin count of the socket where you stick the CPU, they have to match each other. So you choose your processor and motherboard first and foremost. Once you decide what you're going to go with on that, you really need to think about what you're going to use it for. For gaming and video rendering, well, for video rendering, the more cores, the better on the CPU. You know, get, you know, something 6 or 8 cores for video rendering is best. I have a quad core, a 4-core, AMD A10 5800K APU, which means there's a graphics card built right into it. And it's not like integrated graphics used to be. It's much better. It's almost as good as the discrete card counterpart. Okay, so for gaming, a lot of games really just aren't that CPU intensive, so you could even just still have like a dual core as long as you get a real good beefy video card. But, you know, quad core is about, you know, the budget best. So you just have to make that decision based on what you're going to use the computer for. I do some light gaming and obviously video rendering. So anyway, once you decide on CPU and motherboard, your motherboard needs to also have features that you want. If you want to overclock, you want to make sure your motherboard supports that and has all the SATA 6 ports that you need, all the PCI Express slots that you want, that sort of thing. Whether you want USB 3.0 or not, you know, that sort of thing. So then you want to look at which graphics card you want. If you get one that's integrated, Intel now makes integrated graphics processors into the CPUs also. And I hear they're pretty good. But if you want a discrete card, you know, pick one of those out, and that's pretty much it. Make sure you have enough expansion bays and everything for all the add-on cards that you want to put in. Next thing is you want to look at... there's a lot of things to consider throughout the whole thing, cross-referencing parts back and forth for compatibility. You want to make sure, if you're going to get like a high-speed RAM, you want to make sure your motherboard supports that speed of RAM. Mine is dual-channel DDR3. It supports up to 2100 megahertz, but I've got 2 4-gig sticks of 1866. Megahertz. So 8 gigs of RAM, 1866. And then also you need to make sure your CPU supports, you know, what RAM that you've chosen. Then you're going to need to pick out your power supply. I've got a 500 watt power supply. This system probably doesn't even use 300 watts, to be honest. It might use like 260 or 280 or something like that. With the built-in graphics, it doesn't use that much power. But I've got a 500 watt Corsair power supply here. It's semi-modular, which means, you know, you can leave some of the cables unplugged that you don't need for less mess. Make sure that your power supply has the right pin connectors for whatever graphics card you have. If you have a graphics card that requires, say, an 8-pin, and your power supply only has a 6-pin or something like that, then you're going to be in trouble. Or if your CPU requires 8-pin power, and you've only got 4, you know. My power supply supports 8-pin CPU power by the use of 2 4 pins that you pretty much can snap together. Or use both, you know. So we've got CPU. Oh, and if you're going to be overclocking, get rid of the stock heatsink and get something beefier. So we've got CPU, graphics card, motherboard, RAM, power supply, cooler. You're going to need a hard drive. I'm still using the, you know, regular SATA hard drives. As soon as I can afford an SSD, I'm going to go ahead and pick one up. I think you can get a, you know, like a 120 gig SSD to run your operating system off of for like $60 nowadays. So as soon as I get the money and to afford an SSD, I'll go ahead and clone my hard drive that has the operating system on it, and then go ahead and upgrade that. But for now, I've got 2 of these hard drives to go in. And really, nowadays, nobody really puts in DVD burners or DVD drives at all. But I mean, I've already got one, so I might as well just put it in. It's going to kind of mess up the look of my case a little bit, but I think it'll still be okay. Other than that, you just need to make sure you've got all the fans that you want to have. And make sure that you've cross-checked all your connectors, because these fans run off of a Molex, or you can unhook the Molex and use the 3 or 4 pin. And I don't have any Molex connectors, so I've also got this splitter that runs off of Molex for power, and then hooks to one of the chassis fan headers on the motherboard to run 5 fans off of one header. That way you can control the speed on 5 fans via the motherboard there. But again, I don't have a Molex connector for my power supply, so I'm going to have to get one. But I'll go ahead and run all the wires and fans and everything. That way all I got to do is plug the cable in when I get it. Because this is my working computer. I can't be without it for, you know, very long. So anyway, that's the basic gist of it. Your motherboard will be a standard size, like ATX, Mini ATX, ITX, Micro ITX, or whatever. You just need to get a form factor case that fits what your motherboard is. Make sure it's got enough room side to side to fit your coolers in if it's tall. This cooler is 158.9 millimeters, I think. And this case supports fans up to, or coolers up to 160 millimeters. So it was a close call on this one, but it's going to fit. So also make sure you've got enough length to go ahead and put your graphics cards in, because some graphics cards can be, you know, 14 inches long. This little tiny case actually supports a 14-inch graphics card. This is a really nice, neat case. It's got a lot of function to it. Not many bells and whistles, but a lot of function. And I'll go ahead and list all the exact parts that I'm using in the description below in a parts list. And just for fun, I'll price everything out and show you how much it costs. Now, this machine will play any modern game up to today. Some of the newer AAA titles, I might have to lower the resolution to 720 to be able to play it at, you know, medium or high settings. But a lot of games that are 1 year old and older, I can just play on high settings at 1080p, and it's just fine. And this is a 5800K. I mean, they've got like 7800Ks now and way above what this is. Not this, but what's under it. So I'm going to go ahead and finish stripping this down. I've got to take this cooler off and then clean all that thermal compound off, and we'll come back for the build. Okay, guys, so one thing I'm going to mention is you want to work on your motherboard on a non-conductive surface. Cardboard seems to be the best. The best thing to use is the box the motherboard came in, but, you know, I built this computer last year, so I don't have the motherboard box anymore, but any non-conductive surface is just fine. And make sure that before you even touch any of these components, you have either a ground wrist strap, an ankle strap, or at the very least do like I'm doing and just reach over and touch metal every once in a while. The inside of a computer case is just fine. Just touch it to discharge any static that you might have built up. So I've got this disassembled for the most part. I just wanted to mention the thing about a non-conductive surface for the motherboard, and make sure you're grounding yourself somehow. I got to go ahead and remove the old cooler brackets, and then I'll be right back. But as you can see, I've cleaned off the top of the CPU. So there's your CPU right there. And if you were going to be replacing this CPU, this little arm right here, you kind of just push it down and out, and it just lifts up, and that releases your CPU. I don't really want to mess with this too much, but it's got AMD CPUs and APUs have the pins on the chip. And you can see there's a like a gold triangle. There's also a triangle on the socket. So you want to line those triangles up. I'm going to turn this around a little bit. And just drop it in. You don't want to force it at all. Those little pins are super easy to bend. Just give it a little wiggle, make sure it's in there, and then just lock your arm right back down, and it's in there. Okay, so to install most aftermarket coolers, you're going to have to remove these, you know, factory-style cooler hold-downs. So I'm going to go ahead and take this last screw out. A magnetic screwdriver is a must. The magnet is not strong enough to harm anything, and it'll really help you out with the screws. Pretty much everything to do with screwing stuff together on a computer, you pretty much always want to do it like in a cross configuration. So anyway, I'll put the other two in and then come back. I'm going to have a fan blowing or pulling air out and one on the other side blowing. So I'm going to have a push-pull configuration. 120 millimeter fan on each side, pushing air from one side through the other. Because again, my whole purpose in doing this is to solve some cooling issues that I have. Okay, so I see a small, I see a small smudge on my CPU, so I'm going to take another one of these alcohol wipes for cleaning screens and things. I'm just gonna hit this a good one more time. I want to make sure this is good and clean. And then you want to let it dry completely, which doesn't take long with alcohol. If you don't have these, you can just use like a microfiber and some 90% rubbing alcohol. I've even heard people say you can use a coffee filter, so. Alright, so now I'm going to go ahead and put my thermal paste on. And I'm going to do the P method, so I'm going to go directly to the center. And I'm going to put a spot about the size of a P. Now I'm only just turning these in just a couple of small turns just to make sure they don't pop out. So now I'm going to start my other ones just a little bit. Okay, now we're going to go ahead and tighten these down somewhat. We're just going to go in a crisscross pattern. First I'm going to get a different screwdriver. And we're going to do about, you know, try to do roughly about the same amount of turns. Just go a little bit at a time. And you don't have to go like super hard on these things. They'll pretty much kind of just bottom out, and then you just stop. Okay, that one bottomed out. That one bottomed out. That one bottomed out. This one still had a few turns left in it, and there it bottomed out. Okay, so there's our CPU cooler installed. And now we can just, okay. Ooh, we really lucked out on this one. Because sometimes when you have like big, huge like gaming RAM and special RAM, it will, I think we just got by. Maybe. Okay, so when you install RAM, it's pretty simple. There's a long contact and a short. You just want to line them up. And in dual channel, you pretty much, from what I understand with AMD, you pretty much go to the slot closest to the processor and then match colors. So I'm just going to fill up the blue bars here. Hopefully that cooler will allow us to get in here. Yeah, just barely. Okay, now, you want to push down on one side until it clicks, and then push down the other side. Now, it does take a little bit of force, but just make sure you got everything lined up before you go pushing down too hard, so. We'll go ahead and drop this other stick in here. Okay. So there's our RAM. And from now on, we'll pick up the motherboard using the heat sink. Now see, right in there, you can see I put the right amount of thermal compound on there because you can kind of see it start to squeeze out there just a little bit. Now that's okay, but don't let it get down onto the motherboard because that stuff is conductive. So you can short something out. So let's see. So this will go to our CPU fan header, which is right here. Says CPU fan. It's a 4-pin. And when you have a 4-pin fan header, that means the motherboard can adjust the speed of the fan, you know, according to temperature and all that kind of stuff. And on fans, I don't know if you'll be able to see this or not, but there's an arrow pointing forward or backwards and one going across. So the one pointing this way indicates airflow. So I want to push air up towards the top of the case. So I will turn this fan this way so that my cord can come up here for cable management. I could also go this way with it, but I think I'll keep it over here. This little bracket simply just clips on here. Alright, so now our fan is on. And then we can go ahead and take this wire up underneath. Now, I'd love to take this yellow sticker off, but it says it voids the warranty if you do, so I guess we'll have to just deal with that. So anyway, I'll just plug this in for now. And there's only one way, like most things. I'm going to tie this in a little bit of a knot so that it kind of shortens up the cable. Most things that have plugs on motherboards nowadays can only be plugged in one way. So you can't really mess it up even if you wanted to. And that's what I was getting back to saying about it being so easy to build a computer now. Most everything is slotted where you can only plug it in one way, so you really almost can't make a mistake. Okay, so we've got air blowing that way. Now I'm going to go ahead and put another fan on this, even though I cannot hook it up right now. Alright, so there's our CPU cooler with the air blowing this direction in a push-pull configuration with 220 millimeter fans. Now that ought to keep that little 5800K pretty cool. At least it should. So now we're going to go ahead and fit this mamma jamma in the case. I'm going to clean up my work area a little bit and get the case out. Well, which one do you think will cool better? Oh boy. Alright, now it's time to start working on the case. And the first thing we're going to do is we're going to take both side panels off. And we're going to put the side panels somewhere where they're not going to get scratched up. We've already got one intake fan mounted in here. Now in this case, you can remove this 2.5-inch tray and you can actually fit a 240 millimeter water cooler or radiator in here. And you can water cool this. So this case is really versatile. It has a place for 1, 2, 3, 4, and then one in the side, so 520 millimeter fans. But we're not going to use that many. Well, we're going to use 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. We're actually going to use 620 millimeter fans in this case. Because, again, my concern and reason for doing this is heat. I was overheating, so. So here's all the screws and things you're going to need that come with the case. Some zip ties, a motherboard speaker, which I didn't even put one on there. So some motherboard standoffs and, you know, little rubber grommets for mounting SSDs in here. That's another thing. There's mounting for 1, 2, 3, 4, I believe five. I believe there's one on the back side of this motherboard tray. It's either four or five SSDs you can fit in here, and then two regular size hard drives. And this cage can actually be moved forward about an inch to give room to for a water-cooled radiator. So just for now, we're going to tuck this stuff up out of the way. Here's the fan tower. We'll set that to the side. The first thing you want to do is you want to fit your I.O. shield in here. It'll come with your motherboard. It's just this piece of metal that your motherboard fits through. So first we want to get the orientation of which way it goes. So I believe the audio ports usually always go down like this. And yes, I believe. Let me see. Turn this around. Yeah, okay, the PS2s go towards the top, so all you do is you just kind of set that in the hole and then push until it pops in. And it takes just a bit of force to do it, so all right, so we're in there. Now we need to get all of our motherboard standoffs situated and in the right place. So I'm going to resituate and then come back for a better view of that. Okay, so these little brass copper looking pieces are the standoffs. They hold your motherboard up off the bottom so that it doesn't short out. And what you want to do is you just look at your motherboard and you can see where all the screws go, and you just kind of look at it and hold it up and determine where you need to put all your standoffs at. Okay, let's see. And we need one here. We need one here. Now, a lot of times nowadays, your case will come with one of these little adapters for a Phillips head screwdriver so you can screw the standoffs in. It's like a little socket. Okay, so I'll just snug those down, and these really don't have to be very tight at all. Okay, so once you get all of your standoffs in, and you're for sure that they're in the correct places, then it's time to go ahead and put your motherboard in. You want to make sure you have all of your cables and everything out of the way. And then you want to go in at an angle like this and put your output ports into the I.O. shield before setting the motherboard down. And there we go. So we'll set that right down. And now you can look through all of your holes and make sure you're lined up with all of your standoffs. And then we can go ahead and screw the motherboard down. Okay, so I actually changed my mind. I'm not going to put another 120 millimeter fan in the top here. This one's blowing out that way already, and it's only about that far away from it, so it would really be pointless to put another one in there. So this one technically pretty much will be an exhaust fan. This will be an exhaust. And then I'll have two intakes here in the front. So I'm going to go ahead and screw this motherboard down. And again, it's just kind of finger tight, you know. Just a little snug with the screwdriver, and that's all you need. Alright, so there we are. All the screws are in the motherboard. And we're ready to move on. I think I'm going to go ahead and install the power supply now. The hard part's keeping all the wires out of the way while you're working. Okay, so the power supply is very easy to put in. What you want to do, this has a filtered intake on the bottom, so we're going to put the fan side pointing down to suck cold air in and exhaust it out the back. Some people put it like that, but that just sucks hot air from the case and blows it out. And the power supply is one of the most important yet overlooked pieces of equipment in a computer. So you're just gonna put it in there and slide it to the back. Now they used to mount up here in the top, but pretty much all new cases mount the power supply in the bottom nowadays. Okay, so we're gonna come around here, and then we're gonna take the power supply screws, and we're just gonna put these screws in anywhere they line up, which will be four spots. Alright, so like I said, I'm going to have 220 millimeter fans up here in the front. And the case comes with one installed, so I'm going to go ahead and get out another one of my fans that I ordered. And I'm going to run this one with the wire coming out the bottom and going that way. Because the way cable management works in most all cases is your cables will go out that side. You know, tie them all up as best you can. Keep them kind of flat on the back side of the motherboard tray, and then they just come back through where they need to. So we'll go ahead and put this fan. And again, I'm running this as an intake fan, so air's going to be blown out. I'm just going to try to stick this through that other side there. Alrighty. And now, we just get us out some fan screws. Fan screws are special screws. They're kind of fat as compared to other screws. They look like that. Pretty fat. And they actually cut threads into the plastic of the fan. So I'm just going to line it up and then put a screw in through the front. Like I said, I think my screwdriver's just about had it, but I'm going to put all four in. Now I know all this looks intimidating, but it's really not that bad. And we'll go through all that. Okay, so before you all go running for the hills, I kind of want to break down these wires a little bit. Now, every case is going to come with the front panel connectors, okay? So these are for your audio, like your headphone plug and your power switch, your hard drive activity light, USB 3.0, USB 2.0, reset switch, all that kind of stuff. And what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to run it straight out the back to start with, if I can. Alright, see there? We're looking cleaner already. Okay, now this is your 24-pin power for your motherboard. So that will go straight out the back under here. And we'll bring it through this little hole right here. But for now, we're just going to run it out the back. Okay, now all these are for the hard drives and whatnot. Now, if I don't use that DVD drive, then I won't have to even have this second cable, but we'll go ahead and put it in, I guess. Since I have it, I'll just use it. So I'll run it out the back, and then I'll have SATA serial ATA power, if and when I put in a SSD in one of these spots right here, or probably just mounted to the top right here, or mounted up here. Probably mounted up here, and then I've got both the power requirements right there. So this goes to the hard drives, which we'll install here, but with the plugs on that side to give a cleaner look. So we'll push those out the back. Okay, now, these two are the CPU power to the motherboard. And mine only requires one 4-pin, but if you needed an 8-pin, they snap together like that to make an 8-pin connector. But like I said, I only need one, so I'll run one of these just straight out the back and just bunch it up and tie it off somewhere. And then the other one, let's see, it needs to plug in up there. So really the only way to do it is to run it out the back through here and then over the top, which I'll have to do off camera. But there's only one way to plug it in, and you'll see on your particular application how to do it. But the thing about cable management, it's going to be different for every case and different for every configuration. So you just have to try to run your cables as neatly as you can. And running neat cables is not just for visuals. It creates a space for nice, even, unrestricted airflow. So I'm going to go ahead and work on this cable management just a little bit, and then we'll be back. Okay, so I've removed this little hard drive cage, the one that I said could slide over just a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and slide that over in case I ever decide to water cool. I won't have to mess with it. And it's also easier to install the hard drives while the cage is out like this. So I'm going to go ahead and you just slide it in until you get the holes lined up. See that? And then I'm going to put two screws in each side. Normally, one screw here and then another screw diagonal on the other side would be just fine. But I've got all these screws here, so I'm just going to go ahead and put them all in. It only takes a second. And truth be told, I really like building computers, so anything I can do to prolong the process, the better. Now I'm going to go ahead and put this cage back in. I'll go ahead and screw this cage back down, and then we'll get going on the wire management again, and I'll show you how to hook some stuff up. Alright, so now I'll go ahead and show you all how to install a DVD drive. Not that anybody's going to be doing that anymore. Really, I haven't used it in a long time. I don't even really know why I'm putting it in, but I've got it. So what you want to do is, you know, you have to have your bay exposed, and all you do is just push it in through the front. Just slide it back. And then here on the sides, there'll be screw holes. And there, they're lined up. You'll notice I have a grill piece right here. Got to push these tabs in, and it comes right out. So there's that. We're going to just put this back on. Okay, let's see. I'm just going to make mine flush here. You have these slotted screws and these solid ones. If I line up the solid ones It fits pretty well. It's just a hair recessed. I'm going to go ahead. Yeah. Let's see. Flush. I like it a little bit recessed. So I'm going to go ahead and, if you wanted it to stick out just a little bit or something, you got these slotted ones where you can have a little bit of adjustment. But I kind of like the way it's looking on the standard hole option. So then all you do is just take a couple of these fine threaded screws and just screw it right in there. Anyway, that's how to install a DVD drive, and I'll show you how to hook up the power and everything to it in just a minute. Okay, now for me, I believe the hardest part of building a computer are these little wires right here. The power reset, hard drive LED, power LED, all that kind of stuff. Because you have to put them on individual little pins, kind of. So let's start with the power switch. I've made myself a little diagram of how it came off the other case. So your motherboard manual will have the identification of each one of the pins. For me, the spot that it goes on says JFP1. There's actually tiny little writing to say what it goes to. Anyway, so let's start with power switch here. There's reset switch, power switch. Okay, so it has power switch written right on it. So now on the power switch, I don't think it matters which way it goes on. Actually, let's start on the bottom row. So it's going to be the reset switch. Now, like I said, I don't think the reset and power switch have to be like positive, negative, accurate. I think they're just kind of jumpers that that short across the terminals. Okay. Now the power switch goes right above that. Hard drive LED goes on the bottom too. Okay, now apparently up here on the top, on the power LED, does matter if it's positive or negative. The positive is the terminal on the right, so I'm glad I marked down which way they go here. Okay, so there's the hardest part out of the way. Okay, so now I think we can bring in the USB 3.0, which is the blue plug. And again, it can only go in one way, so there's really no way to plug it in wrong. So let's dig through our massive heap of wires here. Well, let's make sure we're not going over the top of a bunch of wires here. Cable management's a real pain in the butt, but it's worth taking your time and doing a good job, because you got to look at it for basically forever. Okay, HD audio. So we're going to go right like... So there's that hooked up. So that's our audio. So we're missing one pin down there. There's always like one pin missing, so you know exactly how to plug it in. There's not really a way to get it wrong. It won't plug in. Okay, so there's our USB 2.0. And it's also got a notch on it, so you can only plug it in one way. Click. Okay. We're getting there. I think it's break time. We'll be back in a minute. Okay, now as far as cable management goes, we've got these little tabs through here where we can hook zip ties or, you know, whatever we might need to tie down. And that's what we tie all our wires to. So I'm going to grab up all these front panel connector smaller wires. I think I'll put them up through here. See if we can get another fold out of it here. Now these don't have to be super Mondo tight, but they need to be tight enough to where they're not gonna fall off. So go ahead and cut that. And then pretty much you just go through and try and clean up all the wires you can. Alright, I guess I can go ahead and show y'all how to hook up your hard drives. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use these 90 degree angle jobbers. And you just plug it in where it says to be plugged in. These are the SATA cables for for data, not power. These cables transfer the data. And then these SATA cables provide the power. So right now, okay, I need to run, I'll figure out those in just a second. But anyway, the SATA power goes on this side, and then those are basically installed. I'm going to go ahead and work with this cable management a little bit and get back to you. Okay, so now that I've got my SATA cables hooked to the back of the hard drives, right here are my SATA ports. Now I don't really know if it matters much anymore, but used to there was like a master-slave kind of deal with the which ports you would use for your main drives and stuff. But I still put the operating system on the first SATA port, and then my other extra hard drive that I use for YouTube, basically. It goes in SATA port 2. And then, let's see, I know I've got another SATA cable here somewheres. Yep, right here. Okay, so this one will just hook up in here into the, I've already ran, you probably can't see it, but I've already ran a power SATA cable to the DVD drive. Now I'm just hooking up the data. And I'll run it out the back. And then I'll run it back down through the bottom from the backhand side so I can make sure we're keeping everything nice and neat. Okay, I think it's time to go ahead and see what we can do with this big old honking 24 pin here. Alright, yeah, that looks a little better. Okay, so that's basically all of our cable management inside the case. And I've basically just hooked up this rear exhaust fan to a fan header here on the motherboard. And I'm going to hook this top fan right here up to this other header on the motherboard right here. This motherboard only has two headers on it. So, I'm going to have to wait until I can get a Molex to run from my power supply to this group of adapter wires that I've got to go ahead and hook up some more, all the other fans. So I'll have a CPU fan, just one CPU fan, an exhaust fan, and an intake fan for now. So I can go ahead and use the computer the way it is like that. I'm sure it's going to be cooler than what it was before anyway, but I won't overclock it or anything until I get the all the fans going. Alrighty, so I got the back side panel on. Pretty much all that's left to do is I need to install my wireless adapter and I don't think I'm gonna install my eSATA thing because I really don't ever use it. I have never used it one time, so I don't think I'm gonna install that. One thing to note that people might not know is these PCI Express slots. See, this only has two short, you know, brass-colored prongs on it. So you would think it would only just go right here in that short one. But it can go in any one of these slots. They're all slotted the same up to, you know, from front to back or back to front. The pins all do the same thing in each slot. So you can plug this in all the way to that end in any one of those slots. I mean, it would be dumb to put it in this one because this one right here is the PCI Express X16 3.0 slot. So that would be for a graphics card. And since I may put an actual graphics card in it later for even more video processing power, and it would probably take up two slots, so I'm going to move my wireless card all the way to the bottom, to that blue PCI Express slot. So, let's take a look at how these expansion bays are configured here. Okay, looks about normal, so we should just be able to take the screw out here. And this cover should come off, which it did. And then now we should be able to go ahead and install our wireless card. If I can keep the wires out of the way. Alrighty. Now we're gonna put that screw back in. Alright. So there that is. Okay, well, I think we're pretty much done. One little piece of superstition, though. You never want to put this side cover on until you hook everything up and make sure that it works. The final touch is putting this side panel back on the computer. So, let me set it back up there where it goes and plug my monitor and mouse and all that kind of stuff in, and let's make sure she works. Okay guys, moment of truth. I've got my mechanical keyboard hooked up, my mouse, monitor. Oh boy. Let's see what happens. Turn the power on. Then let's hit the switch. Okay, that fan's on. CPU fan's on. That fan's on. Let's go ahead and see what she does. So I'm going to go ahead and put that side panel on so I can see how the temperature's doing. Alright guys, so some final results and final thoughts here. So the temperature right now is running about 70 degrees. 69, 70. So that's a good temperature. It is running absolutely balls to the walls right now. I've got it overclocked to 4500 megahertz. That's from 3800. So that's quite a substantial overclock, and we're still running about 69 or 70 degrees while rendering a video in Vegas. So, you know, I'd say that's pretty good. So it was a success, and I'll probably be able to overclock it even further than 4500 if I wanted to. 4500's plenty. I might go 4600 just because I hate odd numbers, but so please, everyone, do not be afraid to build your own computer. It is absolutely simple. You can basically just follow the instructions even if you don't know anything about it, and just, you know, everything plugs in one way pretty much. It's almost impossible to plug stuff in the wrong way. You know, it's just so simple, and it's fun. And in the end, you get something that's way more powerful for the same amount of money than what you can buy off the shelf, for sure. And you get the satisfaction of, you know, doing it yourself. So, I'm going to go ahead and end this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it. If anybody ever has any questions about computer building or components or anything like that, you know, I'd be happy to help somebody put together a parts list or anything like that. So, it's just a fun hobby, I guess. I mean, it's just fun to do. It's really not hard. It's really not. If I can do it, you can do it.